Hey guys, it's Mark Oakley here with another episode of From the Drawing Board, and today, this evening, we're actually at the drawing board, and I just thought it was a good time to rig my little camera up and get the mic going here and do some drawing. I've been at this for a few hours now, just plotting out the latest adventures in StarDrop, and let's see. Let me pull right back out so you can see what I'm working with here. So we're about halfway done the penciling, the writing and the lettering. That took a little bit of time on this one. This is a funny one. I cut away from the story that I had going on with those sort of megalomaniac frogs that wanted to take over the world. Using their powers of froggy mind control, and I left them right on the cliffhanger where Jenny was filling a super soaker with, you know, homemade napalm, and everyone was sort of, you know, a dandelion and a shell were sort of like, what's happening? I was a hard one to write. There were a lot of issues that had to be balanced just correctly. Did a lot of thinking and soul searching about all the issues that surround, you know, what do you do when you have an alien aggressor that's out to get you? You know, can you, how diplomatic are you going to get? And then what are the characters' personal motivations? You know, Eshel's all about diplomacy, and, well, is she? Huh. You'd think that's sort of what she's all about, but she's led great armies in the past. And then, you know, there's Jenny, who is diplomatic up to a point. She's one of those people who doesn't want to get into a fight. And she'll sort of say, well, look, we shouldn't do this, or you shouldn't do that. You got to listen to me. But when it crosses a line, she's done talking, and she's going to take the hard. She's very good at making those really hard choices that everyone's like, hates her for. But I mean, she's in a situation where, you know, dickering around, you might end up with a population of mind control frogs that can genuinely pose a threat to the human race. And she's committing, you know, she has to think, well, what are my core values? One, protect the earth from friggin' aliens. You know, and so she can take a horrendous, you know, she can kill a race off, and she's not really going to worry too much about it. She'll probably, you know, I showed the strip, the couple of strips prior to that. She's like, oh, don't make me do this. I hate this. This is heavy stuff. Why are, you know, and it's your fault. I didn't start this. You didn't listen to me. And now we're here. Fine. You know, and then she's mixing napalm. Where that will go, that will be determined in a future strip. But I thought I'd sort of raise the temperature on that story enough. For the time being, it was time to cut back to outer space where Tom is up to things. Oh, and I'm noticing here, just that level. I don't know if you can see it, right in, let's see if I can bring my, can you see my cursor? Not really. Over here. Well, anyway, this layer shouldn't be in color, it should be gray, so we're going to convert that right now. There we go. Just to keep the file sizes down. And so, well, let's see, where did we leave this off? I'll bring up one of the previous strips, and you can see where I left Tom. Actually, I'm gonna go to my website here, and it is strip number 341. So let's pull that up. And holy smokes, look at all these files. Every one of these files is a StarDrop strip. I've been drawing this for so long. That's a lot of strips. I mean, every two or three, because I've got a couple of different versions of each one. But what did I say, 341? It's this one here. Let's open that sucker up. And we'll open it with Clip Studio Paint. Oh, there we go. And I can show you when it opens where I left Tom. Here we go. So yeah, we had him motoring in from, oh, this panel drove me nuts. I spent a lot of time on this one, and I had this really cool effect in mind. I don't know if I quite got it. I feel like maybe I should have fuzzed out the background a little bit more, made it more blurry. That would have actually been kind of cool. Let's try that right this second, just as a little experiment. We're going to select everything in here. And, oops, what are you doing? Let's, hang on. There we go. Select all this. And then, minus this. Oh, what are you doing? It's not behaving, you silly thing. There we go. Why does it not behave whenever I decide to do a video? That doesn't make any sense. God. All right, there we go. Okay, so this is going to stay in focus. And Clip Studio Paint is kind of crappy for its selecting properties. I really like Photoshop for that, or at least I used to. They kind of broke Photoshop because no one really knows what Adobe's up to. But, oops. All right. Wasting time here. Okay, let's get this in. It looked like a cool effect, too. And I'll do this as well. All right. So, I don't know, let's blur that out a little bit. How do we do that? I don't really know my filter effects. Distort in Clip Studio Paint. It's such an odd, I'm so used to Photoshop. Let's go blur, let's see here. Does it give me any options? Oh, it's thinking really hard. Yeah, that was useless. Can we, maybe there's like, come on. Really? Oh, Photoshop is so much better at this stuff. That was dumb. All right. Let's do that multiple times. So the cool thing in Photoshop, you can sort of set how much you want it to blur. Here it just assumes, oh, this is blurry. Well, no, maybe it's not. Maybe you need to let me have a little bit more control over, I think it's just, it's getting a little blurrier here. Maybe this could have been darkened as well. Kind of want to bring this into Photoshop now. Oh, I'm committed. How does that even look though? Is it looking a little better? Not really. You can sort of see it popping a little bit. Yeah. Okay, we're doing that. Okay, so let's undo all that shit. What we're going to do is open up Photoshop. Get out of here. All right. Actually, one of the funny things in, actually, here we are. Open with Photoshop. One of the funny things with any kind of computer work and this sort of cartooning is that it's a long set of, there's all this waiting time and it's really slow. It's not, you know, it takes 10 hours to draw one of these things. So if you want to make a video, I try and like pick a point where I know it's going to be a rapid development of the image, so it's at least interesting to watch. But whatever, it's late and I'm testing this camera. Actually, I'm really happy with this. I've got like a blurry background, let me see, back here. And I'm using a proper camera. I got my Sony A6500 in there and a prime lens. It's kind of neat. I got like a Canon lens from like 20 years ago. They're selling for like $50 on eBay. So I picked up a selection of those just because you have lots of cool options because lenses are crazy expensive otherwise. So I was, maybe if I rig this up, I can get a neat looking effect. And I think the visual here seems pretty cool. Why are you here? Why is Jenny up and running here? This is what we wanted. All right. Let's try that again. Now watch how much faster it is to select stuff in Photoshop. Here we go. And then we can use this. Boom, 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 boom. Oh, I love Photoshop. I mean, I just wish Adobe would not be so odd in how they... Well, it's not really their fault, I guess. Basically, Photoshop likes to crash, crash my systems. Hang on a sec. I'm getting some weird feedback. There we are. That should help. Okay. Let's put my headphones down there so there's no... All right, now what do? We have to... Here we are. See, I'm able to quickly select using keyboard keys so I can like toggle on and off. And in like Clip Studio Paint, when I try and select an area, you have to do it in like one go. And if you make a mistake, you got to start again. In Photoshop, you can like select and hold down the Alt key and lift the you know, your stylus, and it'll pause mid-selection. And you're going, then you can carry on. It's such a sensible little way of doing, feature. Only Photoshop does that. Well, that in like Paint Tool Sci, but that's like a very old program, and it's still in development. Anyway, okay, enough messing around here. Okay, let's make that look really cool. Let's see if we can blur that background a bit. Let's see here. Here we go. Okay. Hang on. Okay, so let's do a background blur. Let's try a filter and blur. And is it going to do the same thing? Not going to give me an option. Oh. You chumps. Okay. Blur gallery. Just give me some options, man. Blur more, box blur, Gaussian blur, motion blur, smart blur. What do you think box blur does? There we go. This is what I'm after. I want to have something where I can, like, you know, get like a preview. That's kind of good. How blurry do we want to get there? Oh, see, that looks great. This is what I should have done. I think we're going to go with that. That looks pretty good, man. And unfortunately, it's already been published, so makes no difference. And I guess I could try something where I'd, you know, blur the further background a little bit more. That looks great. That's bokeh. That's something I've learned from messing around with cameras. If you lower the f-stop and you narrow the field of focus, everything gets blurry, but you can get a nice sharp image that sets itself apart from the background. Ah, that looks cool. You know what, though? When this goes into the new book, I'll use that image. I'll just save that for reference. All right. We're going to call that blurred. Cool. I'll have to like go in and fix it a little bit, but this will give me an idea of what I want to do. All right, enough of this. Get me out of Photoshop. Goodbye. Go away. No. And back to get actual what we're doing today. So anyway, that was this is where we left Tom. This is the universe that he was left in, flying through a future city with the Kaitana's two brothers, right? And then they're beset by assassins. And this is the panel I left them on. Was like, so a little, you get a little hint of these caped robot assassins, you know? And we are followed. Zalms, take cover. So he's shoved out of the way. So this is where I left the guy. And it's been, you know, several strips since we dealt with that. So time to follow up. So here we are. I figure he's like run a distance, and I have him hiding out behind this pillar. And there's some, is that my pencil? Good grief. That's going on. And I wanted to have some space bug kind of things. I could probably enlarge those. This is a double panel, so this is him here. Oh, you can't quite see it. I gotta get used to. Let's see here. Let's fix the border on this one. I should have some music playing. What do you think? I have to have music being played by. Oh, I wonder. I've got some music. That's where I own the copyright, so. Or at least I wouldn't get sued by friends. Anyway, so there he is. It's just, these are just basic layouts. I'm going to be able to pencil most of these, and a lot of the. There's a lot of mood lighting. So. I'll be spending a lot more time toning this one than I normally would for a strip. So anyway, here you can see connection. He's talking about the two brothers who aren't even on panel yet. I don't know if that's smart. I haven't shown what did I call those guys? They had like two sort of space names, Karoga and something else. Anyways, they show up and you know, he's been sucked into this, like, one of these kind of conspiracy scam kind of arrangements that, you know, imperial royalty, you know, the kids of kings, the corrupt sort of lazy sons get stuck into. They you know, they have all this power and ambition, but they haven't had to work for any of their current status, and so they don't quite value human life and struggle the same way all the mortals do, and they've realized, you know, they've pulled Tom into one of their schemes. They want to set him up to, you know, throw him into combat against one of their enemies, and then they've got some snipers, some, you know, assassins sort of hidden in the ranks, and so there's this very complicated sort of affair, and Tom's just like, he's not a dumb guy. He's sort of been dragged along to this point. And they, everything sort of, I wasn't really sure how he was going to proceed from that. Is he going to go with it? Was he going to show some backbone? You know, he's also got to answer the question, these are going to be like future brothers-in-law. This is family. I've got to, you know, I'm kind of on their team, and I have to take that into consideration because I don't want to make enemies within the family. You know, it looks like I've got enough enemies outside of families to worry about. He wants to do right by his you know, soon-to-be wife. You know, and then there's the question of, like, well, he's not a warrior, and he's in suddenly a Buck Rogers, you know, situation where... Buck Rogers? Not really. More like one of those old John Carter on Mars kind of space science fiction novels where people have swords and it's all, and there's technology involved as well, and it's just it's very Conan like, lots of blood and muscles, you know, big boobed women in bikinis, that kind of a space arrangement, and he's just, you know, he's from Earth and he's just like, look, this is not my shtick, you know, but I have to survive this and I have to navigate it relatively well. Anyway, so he's hiding from the conflict, I guess. So there's some guardsmen that were available for protection, these big dude guys with the black you know, dome heads, that was their protection. Then the two brothers, you know, they have swords, sort of energy swords, and he's just like, you know, pushed out of the way. Not good enough though, because one of the assassins crept up on his hiding place and jumped at him, but he, you know, he has some protection. He had this little drone that he was able to like teleport from Earth. And this is like, look, I know I can't trust anybody here. I need to be able to take care of myself. And this is, and he'd spent some time in this because he's sort of had to respond early to the question of like very powerful enemies encroaching on his affairs. He's not just a dumb college kid. He's got to step up and learn how to protect himself and protect his loved ones. He's in a kind of a cutthroat universe, and he's made the choice to sort of not completely depend on people like Jenny Mysterious. And so his solution to that, and it's one that a lot of guys have to answer, it's like, what does it mean to be a man? You know, so he's faced with that conundrum. And so his solution was like, well, you know, I'm not a kung fu expert like Jenny, and I don't have armies at my behest, but I do have a really strong technical understanding. He's an engineer, so how can I leverage that? And so he builds these little, he's actually done some really, really cutting edge, you know, like engineering. I wouldn't say science, although kind of. He's like, he came at the problem, some of these technological problems from an outside perspective, from a human perspective. So it's like, if you give the same problem to a group of people who all were, encultured in the same way, they're going to solve that problem in a similar way. But if you give it to someone who doesn't even understand what the pieces necessarily are, they're going to naturally come up with solutions that maybe nobody else has sort of thought of. Like if you have a crossword puzzle and you give it to someone like a Shell who's never seen a crossword puzzle, she'd see boxes and some words and not really understand. You know, she might come up with a completely different, well, she would come up with a completely different perspective on it. It might not be anything useful, but Tom's had a couple of years now to play with this stuff, and he's fascinated. He's got a lot of energy, and he is quite smart. And he just put things together in ways that no one was really expecting. And so having a weaponized drone isn't a big deal. Those are things that the Empire knows about. But he was able to come up with this sort of Stargate kind of technology. And so he's got these little Stargate rings that he's able to transport stuff through, and people and equipment. He made a small one. He had this whole project that had been ongoing through the course of the summer, and it got to a point where he was able to, barely worked. He's like, oh God, I hope this is going to work. And he was on a starship flying at light speed or faster from away from Earth, and he was able to, open on a little portal in his quarters and pull through one of these weaponized drones. And so he's got this thing. He's like, okay, drone, you're working. It is working. And so you follow me around, and if I need help, come in blasting. And the drone's like, yes, master, And so that's exactly what he's done here. So he's got an assassin. This stupid drawing took me forever to get right. I think I drew it like six or seven different ways. It would have been the most boring video. I spent like an hour just getting this one picture. I'm not even 100% happy with it. I feel like the hips should be down a little bit. Let's see here. Yeah, sometimes it's always good to sort of, there we go, that looks cooler. Yeah, I like that. It always helps to sort of come back to a problem after you've been away from it for a while. Okay, so this thing's leaping. He's like, dude, blast that thing, and I drew this. This one came up more quickly. I was thinking sort of like, there's a lot of different ways you can draw a robot getting blown up. And I was sort of thinking of Dr. Manhattan from Watchmen when he was first sort of disintegrated in that sort of nuclear, testing experiment. He was locked in that chamber and there was a shot of his like skeleton and silhouette and just, a cloud of light as he was disintegrated. That was kind of, it left an impression. So this is kind of the same deal. My first drawing of this, I had like lightning coming out, and just sort of like zapping the, just traveling through him, through this robot and arcing between the limbs, and that would sort of, knock the robot out of service. But then I was like, nah, yeah, these are sort of sci-fi make-believe weapons, and especially in StarDrop universes, it airs a little bit more on the cartoony side, so you can get away with stuff like that. But the engineer in me just isn't happy with that. So, I said in another panel that it had, disintegrators. I think that's what I called them. I'm not going to bring that one up. Oh, I'm going to bring that one up. It's a fun one. Let's see here. I think it was number... let's try this one here. Number 40. Actually, I can look it up online. Just give me a second. I'm going to go to my webpage, which you can't see. And... no. Yeah, it was... there it is. 339. All right. I like this one. I like doing, you know, engineering strips where... you know, Tom is solving stuff. I don't know if other people enjoy that as much as me, but I like, you know, I like doing that strip a year or two ago when I was like, hey, how do you build a lightsaber? And him just sort of going through the steps, because I think about stuff like that. And for me, it's exciting to sort of solve something in a way that makes sense in my head, that sounds like it could work if the technology existed, but I don't just like to throw technobabble at a problem. I like to sort of really try and, oh, I think if you put this idea here, it's the science fiction author in me too. So Tom's great for that. He's a great little sort of outlet for these kinds of solutions. And here we had, yeah, can you see this? Let's see here. Oh, there it is. Here he is in the suite that he's been given. On a starship. Ah, I feel like I could have done this one better. Like, whoa, you guys don't mess around with your yes quarters. Fancy. And I was like, I wanted to show a lot more sort of luxurious fittings, but this is what I came up with. And I guess it was on a bit of a time crunch. I mean, it kind of works. It's just, that's the problem with these little panels, is like, it's just such a small panel, I couldn't quite get what I wanted. But I let it go. I figured that was good enough. We'll assume that it's fancy. And they have like an elevator with a pull cord. And here he is just like, okay, he's on his own. Man, he's in a crazy situation, but he's got a plan on his key. So he has a keychain, and this is one of the little inventions that he came up. These kind of, his little bat belt, you know, escape, you know, shark, anti-shark sauce, you know. So he has like a little, on his keychain is a little device where if you click a button, it clicks open. You have this little tripod doodad, and it's the ability to, you know, call for a Stargate to open up. And it's generated from a machine in his garage. This thing's basically just a transmitter. Transmits location and the message. And I'm assuming, well, obviously, because he's like, well, he's already talking, like, Earth must be light years behind us by now. So the signal that this thing is able to send out is, you know, leveraging some, I guess I called it, dimensional loop transmitter. That was the name I came up with early on when Ashel was trying to contact her people from Earth when she'd sort of been stranded there. So this thing's using a dimensional loop transmitter. So it's like instantaneous transmission across light years to a distance. You know, I don't know what the exact limitations are. I may not ever quite nail them out, but he's able to send a signal with this thing. His machine in his garage, if I had more panels, I would have shown that whirring up, but I didn't. Got to keep it within 12 panels, and his machine opens a gate and sends a poof. So there's a gate opening up. And looks like I was inspired by, I might have been drawing this around the time when those Marvel movies were coming out, like Doctor Strange and that other guy, when they open up a gate, it's this sort of circle. It's like a sparkler ring. Thought that's kind of a neat effect. Don't know if it's appropriate. I think I prefer to have sort of like a, you know, reality kind of like looking like it's twisting and warping into like a hole. I haven't really seen the effect that I like in science fiction yet. I you know, with Jenny, her stuff just opens up. It's like a time bandits kind of gate. Anyway, this is I'm still solving it all. As Tom evolves his technology, I get to change the shape of the effects, so I get to continue to play with it. Anyway, he gets this thing open up, and you can sort of see in here, there's the little drone peeking through, and he says, come on, pop through. So it pops through, just as his little transmitter and everything just dies. and there he is. He's got himself a drone, right? And this is the thing that's going to save his life. So now he's having a conversation with it, and that's always... I love these circle drones. They're so much fun to draw. You can get so much sort of charisma out of it. And this is Calvin and Hobbes' influence. Like, you know, Bill Watterson could draw like a sneaker, and the sneaker has just like, it's so charismatically drawn. I just want to look at the sneaker and go, man, I'm feeling sneakerness from this little shape. I think Schultz called them, like, he draws sneakers and they look like dinner rolls, and they kind of do. Anyway, Yeah, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to sort of draw a little circle that's sort of, oh, it's got this, you can't name it, which is what makes it fun. I can draw it, I can feel it, I know how it makes me feel, but you can't describe it necessarily in words. And that's why you draw it, because you don't have to use words. So there it is, just expressing all that. And so, anyway, so what I'd said was, let's see here. Disintegrators armed and ready. So I've established the weapons that this thing has. And that meant I couldn't use lightning bolts. So I had to, come up with some cool disintegrator shots. And I'm glad I did, because the first drawing was good, but this one's gonna look neat, especially in here. Like, I like this sort of, I'm gonna have like sort of a glowy, fuzzed out effect on the far side and dark on, high contrast pieces. Let's see, let's get it right in tight. You can't really see my cursor still. Oh, there it is. Yeah, you can sort of see it. Anyways, so that's gonna be a neat effect. And Tom's in the background here. Fist is redoing. And then in come the brothers, you know. So I spent a bit of time drawing this robot crashed out behind it. I don't think I've quite got it there yet. I might have to. Noodle with that a little bit more. And I wanted this head to have that same sort of character that I was talking about. Like, I got it with this guy here. He's sort of looking at the destruction he has caused, but maybe, what would be kind of fun is if I have like a little word balloon from this thing here. And it's just like, and maybe that it's angry. And I have like angry letters. And this one's just like, hee hee. Yeah, I think I'll do something like that. But this head needs more. I might revisit this. Needs like, it's angry because it's been blown up. So we gotta make the brow look. Okay, and that's where we are. And now I gotta finish this drawing here. So I'm gonna do some drawing right now, and maybe I can play some music over the top of that. I don't think I can do that. I'll think about that more next time I do one of these. Oh yeah, I needed a reference for this dude here. What does he look like? He's actually going to be a really interesting character, I think. I hope I get the time to play with him. He doesn't say much, but he's clear, he's sort of wry and he's very intelligent. And you don't really know, there's sort of an Iago kind of element about him, but I don't know if I'm going to have the time or the space to sort of explore that more fully. This guy is also kind of cool. I draw him kind of like me. This is like the evil version of me, the sort of the big sort of like overly confident. This is what my ego sort of expresses itself if it was left uncontrolled and untamed. The 20-year-old Mark Oakley who's just like thinks he's hot shit. Which is funny, and he amuses me. So he's sort of the villain here, and then Tom is, I guess, the engineering side of me, maxing a whole bunch of marks on this panel. Anyways, so okay, all right, we need to see what this guy looks like. He's got kind of a receding hairline. I get the impression like he's the older brother, and he's a little bit shorter and kind of portly and maybe from a different mother. Don't know. Probably not. I don't know the full dynamics of Kaitana's family, but he's along for the ride and in this big plan. And so let's draw him. I think I can remember what he looks like. Actually, let's cut this out here. Copy. And okay. Keep that for reference. Stick you over here. draw him. So he's like contemplating the situation. He's like, ah, oh, I see he smuggled his own war drone in without. He smuggled his own war drone without her realizing. His mind is sharp. So, the classic finger over the mouth, over the chin picture. And they have these big high collars. So, does he have gloves? Assume that they have gloves. Let's zoom in here so you can see what I'm doing. What kind of nose does he have? It's like a little pointy nose. And they have this cape sort of things. They're big into capes in this world. Not quite portly, but he's definitely of a thicker build. He's not unhealthy either. Get the impression that these guys are relatively healthy. Circle doodad in here. And there we go. I think I'm gonna have the brother and Tom. That. And move the lettering over just a touch. Give some space to my layouts here. There we go. Yeah, that's going to be a cool panel. Now, here's the neat thing. Like, this older brother. Tom kind of really lets him have it in this one. He's like, Tom's like had enough, you know. He's like, look, I don't know all that was about, but I'm thinking it might be smart to ditch you guys. Tom's traveled through space before. He spent like a year or 2 years out in the universe. He's been in firefights. He's had to smuggle himself across interstellar distance. He was traveling with George, so he had like a kung fu superstar with him. But he was able to figure out how to exist within the cultural sort of ecosphere of the greater galaxy. He's got some experience under his belt, so he's not a total newbie. So when he says like I'm pretty sure I can find my way back to Earth on my own, like he probably can. You know, he's on a planet with a ton of technology. He just has to. He could probably steal a ship or find passage or ask somebody. He could probably get into a lot of trouble. Like, this is an Imperial homeworld. He could get arrested, but he's a smart guy. He has a drone. You know, maybe he could sell that and find passage. He could negotiate. So it would be a whole cool adventure. But there is a pretty good chance he doesn't need these two guys. He could find his way back to Earth by himself. And when I was writing this, I realized, yeah, huh, that's a good point. So he's in a position, he's not dependent on these two jokers for his survival. And that's kind of a neat place to be. So you can just say, he can afford to be honest. And look, I'm thinking it might be a good idea to ditch you. And he's able to tell them precisely what he thinks. They don't want him to go. They're like, no, you cannot turn back. And I'll have the older brother. What's going on here? Oh, have you crashed? My system's flaky. Oh, good grief. Okay. There we go. Oh, have I lost my pen? Oh, dude. That sucks. Okay. Give me one sec. I think maybe running OBS causes my little laptop to have to think way too hard. There we go, we're back. And my pen's working. Oh, it's not working, check it out. So my pen I put down here and it draws up somewhere not under it. Maybe this is a good time to call this a video. Ah, oh, that's so annoying. Hey, I wonder, hang on, maybe I can fix that. I remember. Okay, I don't know, you can't quite see this, I don't think. But see right here and right here, these are two different drivers for the Wacom guts of this Dell Canvas. Right now I'm using an old driver that Wacom wrote called WinTab, and I like that one because it's good for inking because it's quite accurate, but it has a few flaws. Then there's this new one called Tablet PC, and that's the one that Microsoft wrote for the next generation of tablets. It's quite new, and it works. So if I switch over to there, maybe, yes, look at that. Now I'm under my pen again. It has some limitations. It's not quite as fine-tuned as I'd like it to be, but all right, we're back in business. We can make the video go on a little longer. Actually, you can see it. When it makes quick circles, it doesn't necessarily make straight lines. There's some sort of stop signing, as I call it, but that's a whole other issue. Okay, let's get out of here. Mm-hmm. This would be a good live stream, I think. Maybe I should start doing live streams, because that way I could like be in conversation with people while I do this. Right now it's all just, I'm all alone. I'll look into it. That might be fun. I don't know if there's enough people who watch or care, but it could be a neat thing to do. Maybe when, you know, when the channel grows a little bit, I can get a few hundred people in here and we can just have a fun evening chatting comics and while I draw. That could be cool. Anyways, so yeah, Buddy gives his impassioned plea because, you know, he can't have Tom taking off. He's got his big covert plan of capture the throne or whatever it is that Tom's a required component of, probably more than he let on. You know, Tom's actually quite important to this plan. Maybe he's been planning it for weeks or months. There's probably some, if I were to spend the time, what is going on here? Why do you suck so bad? Oh, I'm going to have to reboot my computer, I can tell. There we go. Oh, stop it. Oh, why? Why? Why do you torment me? There we go. The problem is I'm using like a really old laptop to drive all this stuff. And I got a laptop specifically because it has a battery in it. And so if the power goes out or if there's a power surge or a fluctuation, you get that in some of these old houses. Computer doesn't care. It's like, I'm on a battery. I can run for 3 hours independent of your other, you know, issues. You know, you get your own stuff sorted out. I got my ducks in a row. It's like, I really like that, especially when you're drawing, because there's nothing worse than being in the middle of a picture and, you know, that's no cool. That's not cool. But the problem is laptops aren't, like, they have certain limitations built into them. Okay, so that's a stand-in. I'll probably draw something more significant for the real one. Now, this is Tom able to sort of lay out what he thinks. Is whatever, your plan is obviously super sketchy and I don't trust you. You know, like, he lays out, I have a gut feeling this is some kind of scam or a double cross. You're trying to hurt your sister because sibling rivalries. I don't really know what's going on, but she's told me a little bit about your family. And I know what she was like when she first came to Earth, and she was bloodthirsty. She was not a safe person to be around, you know. She's really tamed herself, or not tamed. She's grown enough of a soul so she understands that other people have feelings too, you know. But I don't know about you guys. And it just made a Game of Thrones joke. I read those rotten Game of Thrones books, and I do say rotten. I understand they were very popular. It was enormous. It was a hit series. I hated them. Not because they were badly written, just because I was like, I can't handle this much cynical, you know, cynicism. This is just like, I think it's because I read the news and I've been studying psychopathy, and I just, you know, not back then, those books came out a long time ago, but I was still sort of aware of the world, and I was like, it's some really grim, dark places. And when I read fiction, I don't want to know about that. That's not where I want to be. I want the talking wolf to not get killed on chapter two. You know, like, how dare you? That's not why. And you know, it's not why I read. And it's not pure escapism. I think there's other things. There's complicated ideas that you can't explore that can be quite dark. But that was just so. It's like, they're all psychopaths. They're all, what a dreary, dreadful world. Like, I just, leave me alone, you know. But I think it might have been good for a lot of the readers because they don't necessarily do that. They believe that, you know, people in government really do have your best interest at heart. Okay, that's not, you know, the headspace I live in, right? So I can see its application. And like I said, they were very well written. Tom is an extension, you know, all the characters are sort of extensions of myself. I do kind of put myself into these comics. I don't do the straw man kind of, what do they call it? You see some of the cheaper, you know, social justice-y kind of strips where they set up a straw man and then destroy it with their little argument. I'm like, I don't like to do that. I like to set up, I'll do that for certain characters, but then I take the opposite argument and post it from the perspective, you know, the opposite perspective of another character. And that's how you get interesting writing. That's responsible writing, in my view. You got to balance it out because no one person's 100% right, and different perspectives have their own value. But Tom has this perspective. I read those stupid Game of Thrones books. Bunch of backstabbing sociopaths, right? And then we wrap it up here. Thing is, though, I'm learning a little bit about the dynamics. Like, this older brother here, like, check this out. I didn't notice it until I was drawing this exact panel right here. So, you know, there's been this battle. The robot's dead to the side. He comes running in, and he's clearly, you know, upset. And his jaw is too small. I'm going to enlarge his face a little bit. Maybe I'll not do it that way. I think we'll go like this. There we go. That looks better. It's a little too alarmed. There. It's like those micro expressions that they study in courtrooms. Well, I don't know if they actually do that, but I read this whole, or saw this whole article long time ago, and a guy was like, let's look at micro expressions. Like, these are like little ways that your face twitches that betray emotions or show what you're really thinking, that you don't, before your conscious control can like slam down and go, show this kind of an expression. That's all done from the your prefrontal cortex, your thinking part. That's your slow, really clever human brain. But the subbrain has got sort of, you know, if your front brain is like dial up, your lower brain is like high speed laser internet, you know, optical fiber speeds. And so your facial muscles will, before you can choose, they're betraying what you really think, and then you can turn them off. But you get this little microsecond before you can start controlling your face, that your actual emotions, your internal landscape is being expressed, and see if you can slow film. Anyways, I don't know how much there legitimacy there is to that theory, but I can't see any flaws with it. So anyway, and so I noticed it here, right? So this is a captured moment, like, you know, Tom almost got killed, but defeated an enemy. And this guy's running up. Holy crap, you know. And that's interesting, because if this guy's a sociopathic, manipulative Game of Throner, would he really have that expression? So I'm like, oh, there's a dimension there that I didn't notice before that revealed itself to the drawing. So this guy might actually not be that bad a dude on some level. I mean, Kaitana wasn't. She had that soul of humanity, or a spark of soul. Maybe this guy does as well. I tend to be very forgiving to my character. I'm gonna make a villain, and then, you know, after like 100 pages, I'm like, they're not so bad, you know. I give redemption doesn't come cheap, but it comes often in my books. I'll try and we'll see with that, what goes with this. And I think what I'm thinking right now is that maybe he's kind of the dumber son, but he's got sort of more power. Maybe he's better placed in the Imperium than his sort of chubbier brother, and there's a great hopes for him in the future. But he's got to like prove himself. Like, I have to come up with a cool plan that will advance me through the power structure, and I just haven't really done a whole lot of that. So this is his big plan. He's got not just to make the plan work, he has to prove to his smarter older brother and to his father and to everybody that he's capable of playing that game and doing it well. And Tom was a key component of it. It might have even been a pretty good idea. And I haven't, to be I'll be perfectly honest, I haven't 100% resolved what that plan was. It's like, insert really clever, you know, cryptic, gothic, mean-spirited, alien, political, you know, scheme here. And I just haven't worked that out. But I can see the edges of it, and I know that if I go in, it will resolve and make sense. I trust that. But I sort of, I understand the shape of it without understanding the raw details. But what I'm learning here is that Tom is a key component to this guy's, you know, big plan, and he can't lose Tom. So maybe he's concerned, but he's not. You can see in his expression, it's not just Tom almost died, it's that, or his plan almost failed, but this kid almost died. You know, kid, Tom. So that's interesting. That's neat. But he's still got a long way to go before he's, you know, a proper human. I confess, I'm surprised. I had more dialogue. You don't seem like a word. I had to pare it down to make it fit. But, Let's see here. What kind of a mouth should he have? Let's try. He's got these sort of. What if he's also. This is an interesting expression. I'm gonna have to come back and fight with this a little bit more. I know what I'm going to do. Got it. Nope. It's too much. Oh, this is a tough one. I don't know if I can actually talk and draw this at the same time. I have to like 100% focus on this. Sort of really sort of feel what this guy feels. That doesn't seem quite right, does it? I confess, I'm surprised. It's going to be more, his face will be like, it's like, what's my motivation? Yeah, interesting. I love this because there's so much facial expression in StarDrop that you just got to nail it correctly. It's not, it's the advantage of these kinds of comics is that I can really, you know, put the writing and the art in their own sort of feedback loop in a way that you just can't with, you know, one of the old Marvel books where you get a script and then you pencil it and you send it to the, you know, there's three or four people involved and they have to sort of be mailed back and forth or handed across, you know, a desk. But it's much harder to draw something, take inspiration from it, and then feed it right back into changing the dialogue or changing the intent of it. It's like it's a lot closer to improv than scripted work, and there's some really, really neat benefits to that, and this is one of them right here. It's like, is this the correct expression? He looks like genuinely surprised. Is that what he wants? Is that what he is, though? I don't know. Let's go the... Now he looks kind of angry, like, ooh, maybe he should have died, but that's not what he wanted. Let's try it with the, he's also got his hand up. Let's try that. Yeah, that's better. Okay, I have the general idea now. Now it's just a matter of drawing it clean. Yeah, music for these things might be kind of cool. I kind of don't like to use the thumb on chin expression because I'm using it here and here. It's a really good one. It really does express thinking. Nothing quite does thinking like this, but to overuse it, you know. I think what I'll do is I'll use it once. here, but I'm going to use it on this guy for sure. Might take a couple tries to nail it. But if I'm going to use it there, I'm not going to use it up here. Because I don't think it's necessary to use that trick. Instead, I'll have his hands behind his back like this. Huh. Yeah, that works. I can get away with that. And it works nicely. There. And then, of course, we have Tom. Now, one thing I can do is have him leaning forward and angry like this. In fact, I could sort of have him doing this. Yeah, it's kept me alive so far, but that's not what we're after. We're not doing that. That's too easy. Unfortunately, it's more, he's not angry with them. He's made his mind up, and so consequently, he's more sort of like, yeah, it's kept me alive so far, so we're gonna draw it differently. He isn't even gonna be looking directly at him. Again, it's going to be a tough one. It's so interesting because you're not just drawing people and backgrounds and action poses. You're doing acting. You're really trying, you know, with a humor strip or one of these self-published kinds of stories where it is the writer and the artist are doing it all, you know, the same person, and you get into these feedback loops. So much of it comes down to what do you do with the expression, you know? It's one of the real strengths, and it's a real joy to do, but it can be very tough to try and get these expressions just right. Because if you look at the expressions in, you know, a standard pipeline kind of comic, you know, where it's writer, penciler, inker, letter, all these people where you can't really affect one another's jobs without going to a lot more effort, you tend to get very generic kinds of, not generic, you have to pick different parts of the word balloons to emote through. And the style that they, you know, use, which is sort of more realistic, you could make faces that you didn't have to act so hard with, or you didn't have to really try and struggle to find what's the emotion they're feeling. You could have, you know, the range of emotions isn't that great. You're not leaning on the cartooning quite so much. And the kinds of stories that Marvel used to tell really understood their strengths and leaned right into them and didn't bother too much with the this sort of the emotional sort of fine tuning, because they didn't need to. They understood. They wrote it in that direction, and that's when you're at your most strong. It's kind of like Tom. Like, you know, he's not a kung fu warrior, but he's an engineer, and he's going to do the engineering side really so well that it looks like, oh, I wish I could be an engineer too. And that's where you're at your most powerful. You recognize your strengths and work to them, and for this kind of cartooning, expressions are everything. That's not bad. like that. I might have to move that forward just a bit though, because I don't want him to interfere with the... Yeah, okay, I like it. I'm gonna go with this. It's kept me alive so far, his brain. He's a little bit annoyed, because he almost got blown up, or almost got killed by an assassin bot, and he's been, you know, abducted by aliens, basically. So, we're going to allow him, he's allowed to be annoyed at this point, and yeah, I think that's, maybe it's too much. We'll see. Anyway, and here's the drone. Now, there are actually other characters in the scene. I'm not going to include them. They've got, like, those two warriors. We don't really know how the battle came out. Maybe for the next strip, I can draw a panel or two that just sort of shows the fallout from this little battle with assassin bots. Geez, I have 5 panels to go still, and it is almost 1 o'clock in the morning. I think what I'm going to do is... call this a video for now. It's been fun chatting with you. I don't know how long this has gone on so far. Wow, there's no timer on this thing. No idea how long I've been going. Oh well, doesn't matter. Anyway, that was fun for now. I might come back and record some more when I'm inking, but I just wanted to give this setup a little go-through. I'll catch up with you guys later, and have a good evening or a good day or whenever you're watching this. All right, cheers.